As I've mentioned before, dealing with CSS, both the class names and the selectors, can be a bit arbitrary. What we're trying to do right now is to develop some principles or standards that we can abide by as our code gets more and more complicated. What we're working towards eventually is a set of standards that lines up very closely with something called SMACSS. So if you go to smacss.com, that's SMACSS.com, you'll go to this page. Don't be dissuaded at all by the lumberjack. The information here isn't nearly as whimsical. So SMACSS is an acronym. It stands for Scalable and Modular Architecture for CSS. It was created by this developer, Jonathan Snook, as a way to standardize on how you might organize CSS. The entire outline of his proposal is inside of the ebook. You can click the Get the Book and buy it here, which I definitely suggest at some point, but you can also understand the basics by navigating the chapters on the site here. Now, if you're really just starting with HTML and CSS, this is going to be a bit over the top for what you need right now. But throughout this series, I'll be introducing concepts that are kind of codified in the SMACSS system. So we've already used one of these ideas. If we go back to the code, the idea of creating classes for sections and then using that class as a prefix for unique styles for any element included in that section is something proposed by SMACSS in order to get around the problems that we've already talked about. I'll continue bringing in different ideas from SMACSS, and I'll try to be explicit about when we're doing that. Something that's nice about the way the author proposed these ideas is that he suggests that with any project, you're going to balance two sides. You remember how earlier we talked about how for many choices in front-end development, there's a sensible choice, and then there's the clean choice. In taking the sensible choice, our goal is to get things done as fast as possible. In going down the clean path, our goal is to do it as right as possible, and hopefully, ultimately, save more time down the road, though that doesn't always happen. So on that clean side, or as I like to call it, the nerdly way, we would end up creating classes for virtually any element that we use in our HTML. Again, that's so we can decouple the HTML from the CSS and be able to change each one independently. And also it allows us not to have to override styles. Now, over on the sensible side, there will be times when we're presented with markup that we don't have as much control over, and adding classes like this might take a lot of work. For example, in Drupal, if we wanted to add this type of class system to all of the markup that's created by Drupal by default, we have a huge amount of work cut out for us. But as long as we try to apply the principles wherever possible, keeping in mind why we're doing the things that we're doing, then we can strike a balance between productivity and preciseness.